Hello, this is Dr. Glasbrenner from George Mason University, and in this video, you will be introduced to the basics of using ggplot2 to create data visualizations. For this lesson on how to create visualizations using R and ggplot2, I will be showing you examples using a dataset containing information about characters from the Star Wars movies. If you would like to follow along in our studio, load the tidyverse package by running library tidyverse in the R console window or within a code block in an R markdown document. Then, run the word Star Wars to check that the dataset is loaded and available. The output should be of a table similar to what you see here. Whenever you are provided with a new dataset, you should perform a preliminary inspection of the variables and observations. A simple question to start with is, what does each row represent and what does each column represent? In this case, each row represents an individual character from the Star Wars universe, and the columns are their attributes. For example, the first row is Luke Skywalker, pictured here. The columns tell us information such as his eye and hair color, his species, his height and weight, and which of the movies he has appeared in. Going back to the full dataset, another way that you can inspect the observations and variables is to run the glimpse command. This transposes the table, so now the columns are shown as rows. This can be convenient when you are working with a dataset that has many columns. The datasets that come loaded with R or the tidyverse have additional documentation that you can access. You can access this documentation in the same way that you can always ask for help in R, which is to write a question mark followed by a word. If the word is a dataset, then you will see information about the specific dataset. In this example, you can use the documentation to answer questions such as, how many rows and columns does the dataset have? In this instance, it is 87 rows and 13 variables. The documentation also explains what the rows and columns represent. So, when in doubt, always consult the help. Let's now make a prediction. What relationship do you expect to see between the height and the mass in this dataset? We will create a data visualization to answer this question. We will start with the tried and true scatter plot. To create a scatter plot within ggplot2, we always first start with the command ggplot, which allows us to specify our dataset. Then we use the geom_point to specify that we want to make a scatter plot. Inside this function, we input our aesthetic mapping with the mapping equals AES, where AES stands for aesthetic. The AES function lets us specify the columns that will be used as the X and Y values in the coordinate system. Here, the X axis is associated with character heights, and the Y axis is associated with the character masses. The result of running this command is the plot that we see here, which shows the relationship between character masses and character heights. Note that this plot does not show every character in the database. In this instance, 28 characters are not shown, as not every character has both a height and a mass provided. Focusing now on the data visualization itself, how would you describe this relationship? Overall, there appears to be a positive linear trend between the mass and the height, with one clear outlier in the dataset. In terms of what other variables would help us understand data points that don't follow the overall trend, the character's name and species would be of interest. Focusing in on the outlier, who is this tall but really massive character that deviates so strongly from the trend? It's Jabba the Hutt. And as mentioned, by knowing the character's species and name, we better understand where the outlier comes from. We can go further than just displaying two variables at a time. We can display more variables by employing the use of additional aesthetics, such as shape, color, and size, or by faceting. Faceting creates a series of subplots containing subsets of data. The specific aesthetics that we can use to map additional visual characteristics to our dataset are the color, the size, the shape, and the alpha channel. The alpha channel controls the level of transparency of the aesthetic. Here we see what happens when we use the color aesthetic to show the gender variable in addition to the character's height and mass. The legend on the right shows the colors that are mapped to different genders in the database, which match the colors that are now visible on the data points in the plot. We can try and see if any new trends show up now that we've included the gender information. In this case, it doesn't reveal too much more other than there being a lot of male characters in the database. Here's a summary of the different kinds of aesthetics in ggplot2 and how they display continuous numerical values versus discrete or categorical values. When using the color aesthetic, discrete variables show up as a rainbow of colors, and continuous variables show up as a color gradient. When using the size aesthetic, discrete variables show up as discrete steps, and continuous variables show up as a linear mapping between the point radius and the variable's value. When using the shape aesthetic, discrete variables show up as a series of different shapes, while it won't work for continuous variables. Faceting is the other way we can display additional variables in our two-dimensional plots. Facets result in smaller plots that display different subsets of the data, and are useful for exploring conditional relationships and for exploring larger datasets. Here we show how the data looks if we facet over gender, as opposed to using the color aesthetic. The gender variable has four labels in it, with blank values showing up as NA. As noted before, this data breakdown doesn't reveal much more to us, other than the database containing mostly male characters. There are several ways to create a faceted plot in ggplot2. In the next few examples, think about what each plot displays and how the code relates to the output. This again displays gender as the third variable. In this example, the faceting is carried out using the function facet_grid. Inside the parentheses is gender tilde dot, and doing this produces rows of facets in a single column. This next example is the one we have seen before. We are faceting over gender again, and we are still using facet_grid. However, in the parentheses, it now says dot tilde gender, and this creates facets arranged in one row and five columns. As you can see, when you use facet_grid, whether the dot is on the left or the right of the tilde impacts how the facets are arranged. To change things up a little, we now facet over eye color, but we use the facet_wrap function instead of facet_grid. Inside the parentheses, we simply have tilde eye_color. Notice that facet_wrap displays facets a little differently. It shows a few subplots in one row, and then after four columns, it continues making more subplots on a second row. This pattern continues until all the labels in the eye color category are shown. So, to summarize, to create facets, we can use the functions facet_grid and facet_wrap. Facet_grid creates a two-dimensional grid. Inside the parentheses, you have rows tilde columns, and use dot if you don't want to split along one of the dimensions. Facet_wrap creates a one-dimensional ribbon that wraps around into multiple rows. There are still another few geoms that we can use. Consider these two visualizations of the mass versus the height. How are these plots similar? How are they different from one another? The plot on the right is what you get if you use the geom_smooth function. This creates a smooth curve that models the data trends. Just like geom_point, geom_smooth takes the same inputs of height and mass. This is a good example of how the consistency of ggplot2 makes it easy to try out different types of visualizations. You often just need to change the word to the right of geom_, and that's enough to create a new type of figure. To create a histogram for a single variable, we use geom_histogram and specify a single variable inside of the AES function. Notice here that we also specified a bin width, which controls how wide or narrow the bars of the histogram will be. Closely related to the histogram is the bar chart created using geom_bar. This is applied to categorical variables such as the gender variable. This provides us with the counts of each label within the gender variable. So, for example, we have more than 60 male characters in the Star Wars dataset and close to 20 female characters. There are even more geoms that you can use. Be sure to check out the documentation and Chapter 3 of the R for Data Science textbook for additional information on the other kinds of visualizations that you can make.